All right, so thank you all for coming today.
My name is Paul Rana. Let me check real quick how this works. That works good.
My name is Paul Rana. I am a Martinist and a representative of a few different orders in town and both internationally. And this is part one of a new lecture series we're going to be doing here at the Austin History Center over the next 6 months or so. Each month we'll have one lecture that we're also trying to broadcast internationally for people who are out of town or part of other, over in Europe that want to get involved in these conversations. And each month we're going to pick a primary topic about the history of Martinism and explore it in depth. Today as part one, we're going to go over the history of the order from the very beginning in the 1770s all the way through to the modern time. So we're going to cover a lot of ground and try to just touch upon each one of these things just a little bit so that we can get all in. And then each lecture we'll go into each section of this deeper in depth and really explore those avenues. So what is Martinism? Let's start with that question. So Martinism, one definition of it could be that it is a Christian school of the Western esoteric mystery tradition that seeks to reawaken in its initiates the knowledge and experience of their own divine origins and powers so that we may once again be enlivened in the fullness of the divine immensity, is the term they use. This pursuit is undertaken not only solely for the benefit of the individual, but for all of humanity and every spirit or being that suffers outside the pale of divine grace. So that's a big mouthful right there, right? And it's beyond our lecture today to go in depth into what Christian mysticism means, to what Hebrew Kabbalah means, the Western tradition. So we're hoping there's some basic knowledge on that, but we'll touch for just a moment. So essentially we're talking about a Christian school of mysticism. This does not mean that it is a religion. This does not mean that it is specifically a religious order. Rather, it is a philosophical group and initiatory order that utilizes Christian symbols and Judaic symbols as a mythology and a structure for self-actualization, self-reintegration, alchemical transformation of the individual. And this is done through a series of initiations, personal practices and meditations, philosophical studies, and group work and private work with your temple brothers and sisters. And as we go through this, if you have any questions, feel free to holler out. And I think I can hear you guys online, so if you have a question, feel free to just jump in, okay? So with that, this tradition commonly known as Martinism was born out of the 1700s French Freemasonry, the high-grade Freemasonry. It evolved through the three primary manifestations, which we'll explore today, namely, the first manifestation of Martinus de Pasquale and his order of the Elu Cohen. The second manifestation, Jean-Baptiste Willermoes, who created the Rectified Scottish Rite and the CBCS. Number three, Louis-Claude de Saint-Martin, known as the Unknown Philosopher, a prolific author and writer. And fourth, through Gerard Ancas, also known as Papu, and who was the founder of the modern Martinist tradition. So the origins of Martinus de Pasquale. His full name was, this is a mouthful, Jacques de Livron Joachim de Latour de la Casa de Martinez de Pasquale. So write that 10 times fast. His origins are rather shady. There's not, no one's exactly sure about some of these origins, but the best we can tell is that he was born around 1727 in Grenoble, France. And various scholars are going to debate this on various levels, but let's say he was born around 1727 in Grenoble, France, from probably emigrated Spanish parents. And we think that his parents were basically converts from Judaism to Christianity. There's also, well, we'll get into that for a moment. What we do know for a fact is that he inherited a Masonic patent. So back then, Masonry was much different. He inherited a patent, a document, and you can see kind of an example. This is his actual patent, which we have resolutions. You can go in and see what's going on with it. It was given to his father by Prince Charles Stuart, also known as the Young Pretender, and the founder of Stuart Masonry, as we know it. On this document, he calls himself, Charles Stuart, King of Scotland, Ireland, and England, master of all the lodges spread over the surface of the earth. This patent gave Pasquale's father and was able to be bequeathed to his son, gave him the right to not only establish lodges, but to make masons on site. So With this, Pascal is essentially born into high-grade Freemasonry. Now, Pasquale, we know that he started truly to come onto the scene in the 1750s in France. In 1754, he was a regular Mason, he was involved in regular lodges, but he was, even back then, we hear a lot of Masons talking about how Masonry's kind of evolved and maybe it's not what it's supposed to be, maybe it doesn't teach the esoteric teachings it was originally meant for. Even in the 1700s, people were saying that. And Martinez Pasquale started founding lodges and then creating his own degrees to try to express more of that esoteric spiritual transformation he was trying to create within his candidates and students. So in 1754, he founded the chapter called Les Juges Écossais, the Scottish Judges, and that was founded in Montpellier. This reference to the judges right away becomes very important in the Yellow Cone. The Book of Judges is very important in that book, as are the patriarchs and the hierarchy of the Old Testament. And we'll see that word judges come up later in the tradition. And then in 1760, he founded what was called the Temple Cohen in Bordeaux. And this is the first time we see the word Cohen, which became the future name of his first order. In 1764, he founded the France Élu Écossais, so the elect Scottish, the Scottish elect. And this is the first time we start seeing him use the word Élu, though there were certain degrees out there, like in the Bailon manuscript, that are already having Élu the Nine, the Perfect Élu, things like that. And this lodge became recognized by the Grand Lodge of France in February 1st, 1765. So he was working within the confines of legal, strict, recognized Freemasonry. But he very quickly began doing his own thing outside of those bounds, which is what we're going to start talking about. So by 1770, his L'Ordre des Chevaliers Maisons et le Coin de l'Univers, which means Order of the Knights, Masons, Elect Priests of the Universe. It's quite a title, of the universe. Like not a priest of Austin, not a bishop of Texas, but priest of the universe. By the 1770s, he had temples in Bordeaux, Montpellier, Avignon, Foix, which is where Saint Martin came from, Le Bourg, La Rochelle, Versailles, Paris, Metz, and Lyon. So let's talk a little bit about what is the Yellow Cone. So without going too much into Freemasonry, we all know it's a three-degree system, and it has been around for a long time. It's been done in a lot of ways. The Yellow Cone grafted itself off of those first 3 degrees of Masonry called Blue Masonry, and he conferred those regular Masonic degrees. At first, you had to become a Master Mason in order to come into the Yellow Cone. But then you come into the Yellow Cone and you take these apprentice degrees, these Élu degrees, elect degrees, and you'd go through what we call the heretical Masonic myth of Pasquale. It is a vastly complicated, yet also very simple when you understand it, mythology based on the Hebrew Kabbalah. At first glance, it seems entirely unique, entirely different, and rather perplexing because it is so complex at first. But when you really start to understand it, you realize it's not that different from the Kabbalistic myths of Isaac Luria, the rabbi known as the Ari. And that guy is the foundation of all modern day Kabbalah we read nowadays, including the later writings of Kunroth, the Golden Dawn, Kosher Kabbalah of Yehuda Berg nowadays. So you'd go through these 3 degrees, you'd re-go through the degrees again, apprentice, companion, and master. The word was not fellowcraft for second degree, it's companion in France, still is to this day. You'd go through these degrees, but in a much different manner. It'd become extremely visceral, and you'd go through them as a mythology of the Old Testament and a Kabbalistic myth of creation. And you would come into the temple and basically be born again. You'd be born in a series of magical circles that were drawn in chalk upon the floor, different amounts of circles, different symbols for each grade, and you would go through Genesis. And then that was basically the first degree, was that birth from the divine. And this is where the myth starts to happen in initiation. It shows in the beginning, God created the universe. In the beginning, God created man and breathed the breath of life, the Ruach HaKadosh, the Holy Spirit, into man and enlivened it, much like a golem in traditional Jewish tales. And then in the second degree, what would happen is man would become tempted. He was given a mission to subdue the spirits that had fallen away from deity. There's this idea in the traditional Hebrew Kabbalah that when the tree of life, or the first creation of the universe, started to be created down, when it got to Geburah, which is the fifth sphere on the tree of life, the sphere right here, the red one, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. When they got to the fifth sphere, the vessels of matter, the vessels of reality, they're meant to contain the divine, infinite light of God, became unable to possess, to hold that light anymore. It became so filled, it shattered. And this is called the shattering, the breaking of the vessels. And in traditional Kabbalistic mythology, this is where creation of matter comes into play. These vessels shattered, fell all the way down to the bottoms of the universe. But even though they were broken vessels, they were still had little elements of that light, kind of like oil. If you break a glass vessel and there's oil in it, that oil is still going to stick to the glass. So that oil is a symbol of the light that still clings to those vessels, to those material bodies. And they would call those the sparks. And if you're familiar with Gnosticism, those divine sparks come into play very much. So what happened is man was created in the image of deity, and he was given the ultimate divine mission to go and reintegrate those fallen spirits, the spirits that had fallen into matter, that had rejected deity, that had tried to be of their own, that had tried to consume the light for themselves. So man was sent in this mission, but unfortunately he became tempted by what we might call the adversary in the Christian myth, or Satan in the Christian myth. And he became tempted by that and fell himself into matter. And this is where Adam Kadmon, the man formed of 22 letters, the divine man, clothed of light, fell into matter and became born of the physical world. And this is basically where we come to today, is that man has lost, we postulate that man has lost that divine connection. It is always innate, that spark is always there, the light is always there waiting to be rekindled and reborn within man, but we have perhaps lost that connection towards it. And the work of these kinds of orders, not just Martinism, but pretty much any mystical order, organization, is to re-enlighten that light within the individual. So in the second degree, they make this very visceral. And you end up going through a series of almost tortures. And we got to understand this is 1700s France. So it was not uncommon to go kill an animal out in your barn and then eat it later, right? So there would be sacrifices in these rituals. Very visceral things you'd go through so that you would experience what it means to be in matter, what it means to be suffering, to be separated from the divine light, to be subject to pain, decay, and loss. So the second degree is basically a very sad degree. And then the third degree, symbolic master, or a particular master, man begins to get his feet back from underneath him again. And it begins to work towards that original charge that he had, that original mission. And he receives from the order magical ceremonies, symbols, signs, grips, words, spirits, things to work with, practices, to help integrate his fallen self. And then we come in, so this is all what we call the porch class, or the parvis. If you imagine King Solomon's temple, we have the porch, then we have the actual temple itself, then we have the sanctuary, the Holy of Holies, all the way in the back. And you follow a linear story in pretty much any initiatory order that does just about that. It goes from the porch to the inner sanctuary. The Ilocone made it very visceral. And they did this through utilizing practical ceremonial magic, medieval grimoire magic. You'll see things similar to the Heptameron, similar to the Lesser Key of Solomon, however, extremely unique in its own manner. So you go through the porch, you'd come in, and essentially you'd start doing these operations, spiritual invocations of beings of light, and then banishings and exorcisms of demons, of the fallen spirits. And this is one of those things in the Yellow Cone that there's still a lot of superstition about. People who are not fully educated in it, there's almost a fear about the Yellow Cone because there's demons involved. But what people should understand is that the Order never gives anyone anything that they're not ready for, and the demonic work that one works with in the beginning is simply that of renunciation and of becoming above it and banishing them from your sphere. It is only much later, after one has attained what he called la chose, the thing, after one has attained the thing, the truth, the light, their divine birthright, It is only then that they truly begin to summon those spirits up and try to raise them to the light, just as King Solomon did in some of the Kabbalistic myths of the creating of the Temple of Jerusalem. One of the myths about the Temple of Jerusalem and Solomon is that the reason why there was no hammer, no tool of metal heard in the building is that spirits were used to build it. It was a spiritual building, and it was built by his ring and his vessel of brass. He would call up his 72 spirits and put them back in the charge of the divine. And he would actually use the demons to build the temple of God, therefore bringing them back to the truth and the light. A very similar kind of thing will happen in the Yellow Cone. So you go through these grades, and this is just one example of the grade lists. It varied because, just like any of these orders, it's being developed as it's being given. He's developing these traditions. You have your first three degrees of apprentice, symbolic apprentice, companion, and master. Those are the Blue Lodge degrees. Then you have your porch class, particular master. That's like an elect master, or a perfect master in Scottish Rite now, perhaps. Then you have your apprentice Cohen, companion Cohen, and master Cohen. Cohen meaning priest, the Hebrew word for priest. And this links them directly back to the line of Aaron and the Levites, those who were the priests of Israel during the exile. Then you come into the actual temple class. This is when like the true high-level ceremony of magic begins. And you have the eighth degree of Grand Master Cohen, also called Grand Architect. So it's a direct reference to the architect of the temple. Then you have the ninth degree, the Grand Elu of Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel relating to the Babylonian captivity. And Zerubbabel being the one that went to King Cyrus and pleaded for him to help Israel to return back to the Promised Land. That is subtitled the Knight of the Orient and the Commander of the Orient. And those have both Masonic style rituals and very magical rituals in them. Then you have finally the Sanctuary, the Holy of Holies, the Inner Sanctum Sanctorum. And this is the degree of the Ro Qua. Ro being, he has a unique spelling for Ro, so it's not exactly red like in French, but there's a reference there to both the Red Cross and the Rose Cross. So it's him showing there his Rosicrucian links. Now there's a lot of theories about where this all came from. How did Pasquale, a man who was not fluent in French, French is obviously his second language, because the French documents we have of him, it's almost like he's writing in broken French, like he's not quite eloquent at it. How did a man who wasn't even that great at French develop this amazing order that completely revolutionized Freemasonry at the time? And one of the theories is that his family was actually involved in the Spanish Inquisition, that they were inquisitors, and that rather than actually burning the books that they had obtained from Hebrews, from magicians, Kabbalists, alchemists, his family actually kept them in a private archive. And perhaps that is where Pasquale got a lot of his learning. Let's take a moment to delve a little more into that. Now, our next lecture, we're going to spend an entire lecture just talking about the Yellow Cone and going deep into this myth. I will just give you a brief 10-minute version of that myth. The next time, we'll go into it, truly the spirits, and relate into how the process works in a 10-stage process. But we can take a look at one of the books that we publish in the Order Martini Souverain, our Martinist Order, is this text called The Yellow Cone Registry and Sigils of 2400 Names. And this is, we are extremely blessed to have gotten hold of this, the original facsimiles. And we have two facsimiles from the 1700s. And these are basically 2400 spirits, sigils, characters that would be drawn in a magical circle, sigils that would be seen in a vision, and then you identify what spirit it was that you're calling on or that has come to you to speak to you. That is also lined up with 2400 names in an alphabetical list, so you can start utilizing these. And this is one example of like the just radical innovation that Pasquale did. When you go through these names, if you're versed in classical magic and Renaissance grimoires, you'll recognize a lot of these names. The traditional Hebrew angels such as Raphael, Gabriel, Mikael, Uriel. You'll recognize intelligences like Porlock, etc. But then you've got these other names that are completely unique that you've never seen before in any other tradition. Likewise, when you go through the sigils themselves, you'll go through and you'll be like, oh, that's a Saturn sigil. But then there's all these permutations of it that are different. And there's a great book out by Gil Lepape. It's in French, unfortunately. But there's a great book called Les Écritures Magiques, The Magical Writings. And it's about this text, and it's about trying to understand where it came from. And he analyzes in that something like 30 different magical alphabets. So he analyzes Sanskrit, Hebrew, angelic writings, Enochian, etc., etc., and various sigil sets from India, from Egypt, from the Americas, from all over the world. And in that, in those tables, he's able to find a good amount of these sigils, but only about a third. The other two-thirds, they came from inspiration. They came from him doing his actual work. And we'll talk more about San Martin in a little bit, but we're blessed to have two different versions of this text, of this original manuscript. One is actually in the handwriting of Louis Claude de San Martin. And most Martinists think that San Martin did not practice magic. Well, here's evidence. It's his handwriting. And the other one comes from an individual named Prunel de Lier, and the manuscript that's at the Bibliothèque Nationale de France. So that's one example of something we'll talk about more in depth the next lecture. Likewise, we've published several texts that help to analyze what the Pasquale myth is. The first Martinists were extremely prolific in writing. Pasquale only published one text in his life, and that was called The Treatise on the Reintegration of Beings. There's a couple English versions out there. There's a really bad scan of a scan of a scan on the internet. It's about 100 pages, but it's incomplete. And it's also kind of illegible, and it's a really bad translation. So it's, you read that, and it's almost completely incomprehensible, because they have their own Kabbalistic terms. They don't use necessarily the Lurianic terms. He has his own set of terminologies created. However, to our aid, individuals like Jean-Baptiste Willemoes, like Louis-Claude de Saint-Martin, in the 1700s, wrote their own lessons to help prepare people for this text. One of them being Saint-Martin's 10 Lessons of Versailles. They're called Instructions to Men of Desire. And we have recently made a brand new translation of that. And we also have the original handwritten text, a facsimile of it. So we're able to source back to the original text. Likewise, Jean-Baptiste Willemoes wrote his 10 Lessons of Lyon, I believe it is. And those are 10 other lessons meant to slowly get you into Pasquale's unique Kabbalistic universe. It's all based on a complex number system that classes these spirits and helps you to understand his Kabbalah. And then we also have a number of other texts that we give out, and we'll go into that deeper in a little bit, that help to prepare someone to actually read that text and understand it. But even with all that preparation, the text is basically incomprehensible without the initiations, because the initiations offer keys to understand why we're talking about Seth, Abel, Cain, Esau. You know, why are these individuals in this myth? And the initiations give you those keys. So this first order of the Eloquent exploded throughout France. But in 1774, Pasquale traveled to Haiti in order to supposedly receive an inheritance. And as we know, September 20th, 1774, he died in Saint Domingo, Haiti. There's still a lot of mystery about his death, because after his death, his students were said to have seen Pasquale roaming the temples, roaming the lodges, even though he's dead. And this it continued for many years. And even in modern-day Martinist practices, there is a lot of evocation, even though they might not call it that. There's a lot of meditations with the origins, the past masters, and trying to bring them into your sphere and actually commune with them. So that's probably the source of where Papu got that from. We also know that Haiti was a hotbed for voodoo, right? For classical African voodoo, mixing with Christianity and Catholicism from the Spaniards. So you've got all kinds of voodoo traditions that come out of there that now have bled over to New Orleans, et cetera, et cetera. And if you go to Haiti, there are still Eloquent lodges that have never stopped operating. And over there in Haiti, it's not secret. Eloquent is not a secret order. When they do their equinox ceremonies, they go out onto the beaches, and just like a Tibetan monk would draw their mandalas in sand and then wipe them away when they're done, they'll draw these gigantic mandalas the size of this room, bigger, with a giant bonfire in the center. And they do this, one of the ones online you can find is St. John's Day in Haiti, which is the same feast day Masons celebrate, and we have our installations of officers. So when they draw these circles, all the different members of the Knights Templar, regular Masons, Elder Cohen, they all come together, the priests, the bishops, wearing their robes, their various degrees, and then the entire town comes out, lay people, and watches and participates in the ceremonies, in the evocations, in the rituals. It's not a secret thing. And even over in France, Martinism is much more open. For some reason, there's this kind of a thing in America where it's become extremely hush-hush. And that's not the way it is most of the world. And I think part of that might be just the lack of information that's out there for English speakers. Unless you read French, it's really hard to truly get into Martinism because there's only a handful of texts out there in English. Which is part of our mission, is to translate as much as we can the original documents and then give those to our members to help re-enliven this tradition. So with that, I should also say that there's probably a lot of individuals out here in America that probably won't be very happy I'm doing this, that we're up here talking about these things. But we will never reveal anything that's going to ruin the initiatory process. We're not revealing any secrets that you can't find with a little bit of study and reading the text of A.E. Waite, of Robert Amadou, of Robert Ambalon. So we know what is out there, and we're being careful just to give the things that you can already find your own. But we're trying to do it in a way that brings it together for comprehension. So the Elder Cohen, this might not be that easy to see, but this is an example of two different magical circles that would be used in initiations. Two different grades, two different operations, and you come into this circle, and hard to see right now, but these are all candles. Each candle is a spirit, and underneath that candle, you'd write the spirit's name and its two sigils, and you'd call up that spirit in your operation. And various things would happen to bring light to the earth, to banish the darkness, etc., etc. Much like any tradition, just much like Buddhist Tonglen. And then this one over here is another one like that, where this is an exorcism you're performing. And you have essentially all these spirits right here that are demonic spirits. And you're calling forth all these spirits of light to banish that darkness, which is symbolized by the snakes. So just an example of some of the work. And you'll see more of that in our next lecture. Any questions on that whirlwind of the yellow cone? Comprehensible to a degree? Okay, cool. Yes, sir. And in December, I believe it's in December, we're going to be doing another lecture here with another group. We're called Rosicrucian Philosophers in the Public. And we're going to do a full lecture on Introduction to Kabbalah. We'll spend 2 hours going through the various versions of the Tree of Life using a Lurianic lens. And we're going to talk about everything from before creation. And we can summarize this real briefly. Basically, before creation in Kabbalah, you have the infinite. Deity, the all, the one, was everywhere in everything. There was nothing that was not him. It was just deity. And in order to create, deity had to create a space in which it did not exist. Otherwise, it could not create anything, because it's already everything. And they call this in Kabbalah the Zimzum. And one way to visualize this is an inhalation. So you can imagine that deity inhaled a little sphere within creation, within reality, a negative space in which nothing existed, a vacuum, And by creating nothing, he now created a place he was not, and it could implant itself in it. So deity exhaled its spirit into it. And that spirit can sometimes be called Sophia, the Shekinah, the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, which in the Holy of Holies of the Hebrews would be symbolized by the Ark of the Covenant, and specifically the mercy seat. The Ark of the Covenant had two cherubim that flank it, Metatron and Sandalphon. And then in the center, the high priest would go in there and meditate before the Ark and wait for the Shekinah to manifest, which is feminine. That is that Sophia aspect. And Gnosticism has a lot of versions of that myth, and we'll explore those much more in depth at our Kabbalistic lecture. But yes, that is good to bring up. And it's important to note that we're using this tree life diagram because it's familiar. But they never use the tree of life diagram in Martinism, ever. And if you ever see it in a Martinist temple, that's something they've done the last, like, 50 years. It's new. They use this diagram called the universal table, which you guys who are online, you can easily look up universal table and find versions of this. This universal table is kind of similar to the tree of life as far as a hierarchy going down in spheres, but it's also very different. You still have this divine immensity where God was everywhere, and then you have this space, you breathed a negative space, and then manifestation. And then from this, all the divisions come down. They have worlds they call the immensity sur celeste, the super celestial world, which would be, I guess, what we call heaven. And then you have the celestial world, and that is the planets, the sun, the moon, the stars, etc., etc. Then all the way down here at the bottom, you have the immensité terrestre, so the terrestrial immensity, Earth, which is symbolized by a downward-pointing triangle facing the west. And within that is a Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, the divine name of Yehovah. And it's showing that the lost word, the spirit, is still in matter, even though it's trapped, even though it maybe is not awakened and enlightened. So that brings us back to the original purpose of why we're doing this, is to reawaken the word in Christian terms. From John 1, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. The same was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and this light was the light of men. And the light shineth in the darkness, but that darkness comprehendeth it not. And we are essentially that darkness that is seeking to comprehend the light and to understand it and manifest it. So, and again, we'll go much more in depth into that in the next lecture. Cool, on good track. So the next, that is the first manifestation of Martinism, Elohim. Now, after Pasquale's death, there were several temples, there were several roquas, there was a sovereign tribunal, but without his genius and his direction and his motivation and drive, the order just, it began to fall apart. It didn't have its spiritual chief anymore, its driving force. So it didn't take long for those temples to slowly start to die off. People were still being initiated, but before long, the order essentially went dormant. So with that, we're going to talk about two of Pasquale's primary students, Jean-Baptiste Willermoz and Louis-Claude de Saint-Martin. They both took the Martinist myth, the Pasquale-Elohim myth and philosophy, and preserved it in their own ways so that the tradition would not die out, the primordial tradition, the secret tradition. So one of those, the first one we're going to talk about is Jean-Baptiste Willermoz, which he is, his tradition is sometimes called Willermozism, and Pasquale's is Martinezism, and then Saint-Martin, Martinism. Funny terms, but it helps you to understand what we're talking about. Jean-Baptiste Willermoz was a high-grade French Freemason, just like all of them, and he was a member of the Sovereign Tribunal, so he was one of the chiefs of the Elohim. Now, Willermoz took over the strict observance Templier. That's the French word for the Templar strict observance, which still exists today as the strict observance in Freemasonry. A regular Masonic rite. He took that over. It was a German high-grade Masonic rite. He took over from Baron von Hunt. And the strict observance had, by its name, Templar, had a lot of Templar influences into it. And it had this mythology about the Masons having a direct lineage back to the Templars. Now, at some various conventions, they basically proved that was rubbish. At least at that time, they believed it was rubbish. And the order kind of went into abeyance. Instead, what Willermoes did, he revised these rituals and created the RER, the Rite Equisse Rectifiae, or the Rectified Scottish Rite. One of the first times we see that word used. And it's not anything like the Scottish Rite, the ancient accepted Scottish Rite we know now. It was completely different. And this became the official Masonic Rite of the Grand Lodge of France. In 1778, there was the National Convent of Lyon, and that is where the Masonic Code of the Reunited and Rectified Lodges uses was drafted and approved. And that's in this text that we give out to our members who come into this order and take the degrees. So we always try to reference in our specific order all the original source documents. We try to go back to the source. So this was a code of how the Rectified Lodges would operate. The hierarchy, the bylaws, et cetera, what the initiations like, dues, dignitaries, et cetera, et cetera. So this became official Masonry in France. Now at this same, we'll get to there in a second. Then we have, he also created within the RER, so the RER had 3 degrees, apprentice, companion, master. And it had a high degree, a 4th degree, called Scottish Master of St. Andrew. And that was called Green Masonry, because the temple was green. And we'll get into that more in a moment. Now, Willermoes also created within the RER a secret inner order called the CBCS, the Chevalier Bienfaisant de la Cité Sainte, which means the Beneficent Knights of the Holy City, a reference to the Knights Templar, the Beneficent Knights of Jerusalem. Their rules were approved at the Convent National de Gaulle, which was held in Lyon, in September and October of 1778. So you had the RER created, and then secretly the CBCS created. And this is a secret inner order of the degrees of 5 and 6, Squire Novice, Écuyer Novice, so basically a knight's like maid, a knight's helper guy. And then you had Beneficent Knight, CBCS is a 6th degree. And that was a full spiritual knighting. Then lastly, in 1782 at the Congress of Wilhelmsbad, the Masonic rule for the Reunited Lodges uses, subtitled, often called nowadays, the rule of the Order of 9 Points was approved. And those are the primary foundation legal documents of that order. Now, this is a very interesting time in high-grade Freemasonry, because in France, you had Adam Weishaupt's Bavarian Illuminati. You had, in Europe in general, you had Adam Weishaupt's Bavarian Illuminati. You had, which are recently published, those new degrees, Joseph Wages published a book just last year with all the original Illuminati degrees, and it's quite interesting to read. Then there is obviously the RER and CBCS. There was the Strict Observance. There's the Golden Rosenkreuz, the Alchemical Rosicrucian Order. There's the Asiatic Brethren. There's all these different groups going on. And basically at the 1778 and 1782 conferences, there was a battle for who's going to win out, who's going to become the official branch. And Weishaupt's group got really upset because they lost. And Willermoes' branch basically took over. But then, so there's this big myth you can read about Weishaupt and Willermoes butting heads, about these different dignitaries trying to shut each other down at these conferences. And that was all true until the French Revolution. Once the revolution happened, basically anyone who was of the elite, of the ruling class, was under threat. And that included all of these guys. You know, Saint-Martin, Willermoes, they were all French dignitaries, you know, of noble birth. Even if lesser nobles, they were still of noble birth. So what happened is, with that Enlightenment era, and with this reaction of modern science back then, which is extremely primitive, these mystical orders felt like they were threatened they might die out. So one thing people very rarely talk about is that in reality, after Revolution, 1791, these orders united. And there's an order that people never talk about. It's been published in 2 books, like a paragraph. And there's an order that, based out of different groups that brought all those streams together and still exists to this day. And this has been perpetuated by French royalty and Swedish royalty and Norwegian royalty. So just something to realize that though there were those battles, in the end, they all united. So The CBCS, what is the CBCS? The CBCS works through the Masonic framework at first. It was originally a legal Masonic branch. It still is a legal Masonic branch. In France, there's even legal Masonic branches in America, such as New York. But it's one of those very few orders that was legally allowed to split off from Freemasonry and initiate outside of it and without consequences. So therefore, you have high degree of grand masters of states, of countries, who are in these non-Masonic CBCS lodges and orders. And it's completely accepted. Some of the highest names you guys know of as Masonic authors are members of these orders. And all you gotta do is search the internet for books they write. So you have those first 3 degrees, and then that follows, in those first 3 degrees, the RER that Willard Mose revised, it follows the basic Masonry we're used to. However, he starts implanting little seeds of Elo Cohen in it, little seeds of Pasquale's heretical Masonic Kabbalistic myth. And they're subtle at first, but when you know what you're looking for, you see them there. And little seeds like uses of the elements, uses of various motions and signs and symbols. And then when you come into the fourth degree, which was an invitation-only degree that people knew about, but you had to be invited into, the Scottish Master of St. Andrew, you come into that degree and you go through kind of a spiritual version of Masonry now. Still Masonic framework, you're not like invoking spirits or anything yet. But you go through a reenactment of the first 2 degrees and they show you the spiritualized aspect of it. The spiritualized aspect of the myth of Hiram, and there's a resurrection that occurs. Like, there's some really cool things that happen. And it is extremely Kabbalistic, and it is based essentially on the destruction of King Solomon's temple and then that eventual rebuilding of the spiritual third temple. And for most people, that is where the St. Andrew degree stopped. As we have, in our CBCS here, locally and internationally, as we have revised our degrees and started using them, we were blessed to get access to the original 1778 handwritten text of Willard Mose. So we've translated those ourselves from the French. We also have possessing all the various versions of the 1900s, English and French, of Grand Lodges. And we brought these all back together to try to go to the original source, but then make it practical and actually initiatory. With that degree has a lot of just amazing imagery and diagrams and just some really beautiful moments using the square and compass in unique ways. So for most people, though, that was the top of it, Green Masonry. Then there's this secret inner order you mentioned, the CBCS, White Masonry. And you come in to a very different temple, and the CBCS isn't that secret anymore. You can see Grand Masters on Facebook posting their CBCS initiations. I'm not going to show you those, because I'm not going to show you what temples, but you can go online and find them, various versions of them. And you essentially have this Templar Beauxsaint, right? So the black and white flag. And you'll see this done in different ways. White above, black above, left and right. But as far as we can tell, the original version was supposed to be black above, white below, at least in the CBCS, with the red cross in the center. One of the explanations of that is that it's a war flag, right? And it shows the darkness of war, the darkness of matter. But still, hidden within that is the divine light, the seed, that divine spark we were talking about in the Pasqualian method. So it's even there, just in a symbolical manner. And then that cross is that unification of the above and below. You'd come into the Squire Novice, and it is an extremely Christian order, extremely Christian. The officers are the Grand Prior, which has religious overtones to it. You have the like the Pontiff, and there's an officer that specifically just does invocations and prayers today, Christian invocations. And you essentially go through the Squire Novice and you take a lot of oaths and you get a big stack of rules of how to be a knight and how to train to be a knight. And you are trained in trying to manifest the Christian virtues, the knightly chivalric virtues. So whereas the Elo Cohen trained the individual through magical invocation, aspiring toward God, and cleansing yourself of demonic influence, of dark influence within and without. The CBCS does it through practice of the virtues. Essentially the same thing, just without spirits. Then you come into the sixth degree, beneficent knight, and you get a full knighthood in the tradition of the Templars, sword dubbing and all. And you get a lot more prayers, a lot more rules and obligations, many of which don't apply to us anymore, because we're in the modern age. So most modern orders have changed some of those obligations. Then you have a double secret class, a secret inner order of the CBCS that even those knights didn't know about unless you were invited to this inner order. And this was the seventh and eighth degrees of professed knight and grand professed knight, or shortened mostly as grand prof, is what you'll see it written as. And these are the degrees where they pulled away the veil and they show you, this whole time, we've been preparing you for ritual magic. We've been preparing you for Elokon, for Pasquale's men. And those degrees are not so much degrees as they are lectures and lessons. And again, we're blessed to have the original handwritten manuscripts from the Bibliothèque Nationale de France, FM 4509, I think it is, that were able to rectify some of those errors that have been made in translations since then. Those lectures are basically Cliff Notes versions. By Cliff Notes, I mean like they're still like 80 pages. Cliff Notes versions of Pasquale's Reintegration of Beings. And it's them distilling down the Kabbalistic myth. So they're like, everything we built you up is for this. And then it is rumored that at those degrees, they began full Elokon initiations. And we'll get more to that in a little bit about where what happens after that grand professed degree. So essentially, we have the magical tradition of Pasquale on one end, one extreme. We have the other extreme of Masonic, knightly, Christian, Templar virtues, and the other one, Willemers. Okay? Any questions about this section where we're at right now? All right, cool. So let's move on. And here's an example. I know it's hard to see, but this is an original 1778 tableau of a Scottish master of St. Andrew's Lodge. And this is, you can find this if you just know how to search the archives of the French National Library. And this is an example of one of our modern diagrams of the Templar shield with the pelican nourishing its young from its own heart. So lastly, we come to the one that people talk about the most, and we're actually probably going to talk about the least, because he's already out there already. Louis-Claude de Saint-Martin, the unknown philosopher. Most Martinists, this is the person they identify with. And I think that's usually because people just aren't educated on Willemers and Pasquale. Scottish Rite Masons tend to be fairly educated on Willemers because some of his degrees are still practiced around the world, but in a watered-down way. It's lost a lot of the magic. So Saint-Martin was born in January 18th, 1743, in Amboise, France, to lower noble parents. There's so much written out there on his history, so we're not going to go too far into it. But there's also a lot of bad things, like a lot of like bad intel out there. A.E. Waite, for example, writes that he was an extremely frail individual. And he was so pious and so holy, and like he was almost a sickly man. And I'm not really sure where that came from, because a lot of our other evidence points to the exact opposite, which we'll talk a little bit about. He was originally raised to be a barrister, to be a lawyer. But he just didn't have any desire to do the law. He ended up joining the military, and specifically the Foix Regiment. And it is there in the Foix Regiment, back then and even nowadays, but especially back then, they had military lodges. So a regiment would also be the name of a lodge. And you can actually go through the French libraries and download the original member lists and meetings of these regiments. You have to search quite a while to find the right ones. But you can find the Foix Regiment and their member lists. He was initiated in the fall of 1768 to the Elokon. He served as Pasquale's secretary. He was his personal secretary. Took all his notes, wrote everything down, did all the communications between temples, etc., etc. So he was extremely closely tied in with Pasquale. He was one of his brightest students. He rose to the ranks quickly, became a Rokois, became a sovereign of the order, and an initiator. He was a member of the Sovereign Tribunal, which was their grand council. One of the famous quotes we see repeated a lot about Martin, Saint Martin, is him asking his master, Pasquale, "Master, is all of this really necessary to pray to God?" Meaning like all the magical formulas and circles and prayers and spirits and insanity. And Pasquale said, "We must make do with what we have until someone makes something better." Or if it's a paraphrase. But basically, this is what we got. So, no, it's not necessary, but this is one way to do it. And now in the Martin tradition, we have three different ways to do the same thing. Some are more efficient than others. Some might be better than others at getting to the final realization. But there are different modes for different temperaments. So that's when we start seeing people talk about how Saint Martin moved away from what we would call the operative or magical path, theurgy, and ceremonial magic, and began moving towards what is now called the inward path, or the voie cardiaque, the way of the heart. And he was heavily influenced by the theosophy of Jakob Boehme, a German shoemaker who, I don't know how, but I don't know where he got his education, but a German shoemaker that was an extremely prolific writer and artist that wrote fantastic Rosicrucian alchemical texts and theosophic texts that we're still studying today around the world in all kinds of organizations. And if you've not read any Jakob Boehme, hit me up. I'll send you like a Dropbox of thousands of pages. There's so much good stuff. Now, there's rumored to have been a Societe des Intimes, a society of intimates, or society of initiates, but in reality, as far as we know, Saint Martin never created his own order. He never created Martinism. This would have happened 100 years later. Basically 85 years later, happened after his death. But he did, however, bring together, he was, however, a very prolific author. And we published all of his texts that we have in English for our members. And a lot of them you can already find online, some better, some worse translations. But he was a prolific writer. His very first book was called On Errors in Truth, Des Erres et de Vérité. And Piers Vaughan, out of New York, who is one of the most highly respected American Masons from England, but lives in New York the past forever. He is about to publish, through his Rose Circle Books, a new translation of Errors in Truth, which I'm greatly looking forward to. Because we have a good translation, but not as nearly as I'm sure his is going to be. So Errors in Truth, his first book, was basically a refutation of the Enlightenment era, of the modern science that was coming out. And this gives background to why the Elocrome had to exist in the first place. France was becoming more and more secular every day with modern science. And people were losing, and then there was the Reformation, and there was just all the stigmas of the Catholic Church and religion in general. So people were losing a lot of that spiritual connection that it was ingrained in their being. They needed to have that spiritual connection. Saint Martin's book, Errors in Truth, is a refutation of modern science. And it basically points out all the ways that it's totally wrong. Now, when we read it, that book now, we're like, oh, yeah, duh. Like, because a lot of those theories back then were pretty weak. And our modern science is nothing like what they had then. But it's still an interesting period piece about it. And he talks a little bit about mysticism in it, but not very much. It's mostly refutation. However, some would say there is a section that has the real secret in it, the key to enlightenment, Philosopher's Stone, in its text, for those with eyes to see. Regardless, when he first published that book, he went out on a speaking tour throughout all of France, and he was a rock star. Like, he was received in all the highest royal courts, and hung out with all the duchesses, and he was liked to party and hang out with people. So the idea that he was this frail, extremely noble individual that was so pious doesn't seem to hold up in reality. Not to say that. And what that should do for us is shatter the illusion that in order to be a spiritual individual, you have to sit and pray 20 hours a day, or you have to be a vegetarian, or you can't drink alcohol. Okay, because they were doing these things. So he never founded his own Martinist order. He died October 14th, 1803 in Châtenay near Paris. He's written so many books on numbers. He's written a book, The Ten Prayers of San Martin, which are 10 prayers that basically teach you how to pray. And you could easily line those up with the 10 Kabbalistic Sephirot. He wrote The Red Book. He wrote his last book that he published, which is my personal favorite, is called Man, His True Nature and Spiritual Ministry. And it's in three sections. Section one, I might get this backwards, but God, nature, and the Word, three sections. And it analyzes reality through the lens of God, nature, and then the Word, and tries to tie those all together. But what's beautiful about this book is that it's written near the end of his life, and he basically just pulled out all the stops. He's not trying to veil things anymore. He's not trying to make these complex things. He's just giving the theosophic lessons to you. He's giving you the secret tradition in a simple book to digest. So if you would like to read San Martin, I would begin with that book, Man, His True Nature and Spiritual Ministry. It's the clearest, the easiest. So let's talk about the development from him. Like we said, San Martin never actually created a Martinist order. He did, however, have book clubs. He'd have groups that would come over to his house, individuals that would study one-on-one or in small groups. And one of the myths about him is that he conferred a one-on-one initiation, kind of similar to an ordination in a Gnostic church or apostolic church, similar to a Buddhist empowerment or a Reiki empowerment or something like that. But even then, it's mostly conjecture if that actually existed or not. We do know that he removed himself from all masonry before the end of his life. He completely removed himself from lodges and asked for his name to be stricken. He did not want to be associated with Freemasonry anymore. However, the people that say that he was not a magician, that he was not an active Elocon member, he remained an active Elocon member to the day he died. And we have evidence of that with our texts, where he hand-wrote 2,596 magical sigils. And it's identical to Cornell de Lier's. Basically, in these old orders, you'd get a manuscript and you'd be asked to copy it by hand. And that would be your personal copy, so you're gonna make sure you do it right. Otherwise, you know, you're gonna have messed up spirits. So we know that he was a magician. He was a practicing mystic and magician. But he is attributed to the Way of the Heart. And this comes in really in 1882. This comes out 80 years later, after Martinus' death, is when Henri Delage, Papou, Augustin Chabazot begin to create the first Martinist order, what we would call the third manifestation of Martinism, what most people commonly call Martinism now. So, to jump forward 80 years, in 1882, there was the initiation of Papou by Henri Delage. Now, this initiation was a spiritual affiliation only, with no traceable lineage back to San Martin. It was an inspired initiation. And we're not exactly sure, maybe, what happened in that. I'm sure we could research it, but it was a spiritual affiliation to San Martin, the unknown philosopher. And then in 1886, Augustin Chabazot, a very important name that we're going to see in the next 50 years of Martinism, was initiated by Amélie de Bois-Mortemart. Notice that's a woman. The Yellow Cone was one of the first orders, Masonically, to initiate women. Jean-Baptiste Guillermo's sister became a Roquois and a sovereign of the order. And this was the 1770s we're talking about. They were already initiating women. They were very ahead of their time. She was initiated by Henri de Latouche, who was initiated by Adolphe de Sabrolle, who made a spiritual affiliation to Saint Martin with Antoine Hanequin. But again, there's no fully traceable lineage. There's a missing initiator there. In 1887, Papou founded officially L'Ordre Martiniste, the Martinist Order, the OM, or in America we call it MO, generally. But OM is the French version, which conferred initiation inspired by Saint Martin. Now, this new Ordre Martiniste was based on the Masonic system of 3 degrees. It is said that there really only is one Martinist initiation, and that is the degree of SA. The first 2 degrees are merely preparatory degrees to get you ready for that spiritual transmission, that etheric link. And we'll talk more about that in a moment. Now, in 1891, Papou formed his sovereign council, his grand council, of the Ordre Martiniste, known as the Supreme Conseil. The original Ordre Martiniste and almost all of its successors, numerous successors and Martiniste offshoots, utilize a three-degree system: associate, initiate, superior, and commune. And you're only considered truly a Martinist at SI. The first two are preparatory. Just like Masons, an apprentice can't wear a Masonic ring, or shouldn't. A fellow crafter shouldn't wear a Masonic ring. Only at the master you're like truly a member, a Masonic member. So at the third degree is where you get that full affiliation. And we're gonna talk about those degrees in just a minute. Then there are further degrees beyond that are administrative degrees. In Martinism, there really is just those three degrees. But then every order is gonna be different here. Some orders utilize different titles, some do it different ways, but it's pretty common that there's something called CI, Consecrated Initiator. And it's essentially a consecration, kind of like a Gnostic or a apostolic order, in which you're conferred by a bishop the right to be a deacon, or the right to be a priest, etc., or a cleric, or a doorkeeper, or a lay servant. And this CI consecration gives you the right to initiate to the first two degrees only, so associate, initiate. There is a fourth degree, administrative, called superior and commune initiator, and that means unknown superior initiator, SII. And this is what gives the individual the right to make SIs, to initiate up to the third degree. Lastly, you'll see a slew of different titles for the same degree, either SIIL, Superior and Commune Initiator Liber, Free Initiator, or SIIV, SII Fourth, or even SIGI, Superior and Commune Grand Initiator, or also we see that term in the Scottish Rite now. It could also mean Superior and Commune Grand Inquisitor, or Grand Juge, come back to the judges again. This is done in different ways and orders. There's the SI, and then there's the Free Initiator. And there's been a lot of politics about this. A lot of orders have done away with the Free Initiator, because a Free Initiator means that you have the right to leave an order and go found your own. You have the right to become a Grand Master, much like Pasquale's patent that his father gave him back in the 1700s. It gives you that right to found lodges and found grand lodges. So there are still a few orders that use that, but generally the Free Initiator, people work outside of order systems. And it'd be like, I come to a brother and be like, do you want to become a Martinist? We do it privately, one-on-one. And we'll get a little more into that as we show you how we developed our order. That third degree, Superior and Commune, SI, is a very important term in Martinism. It means unknown superior. And there's this idea in Martinism, I'm not sure if you saw those pictures of the masters each slide, but their faces are blacked out, they're silhouettes. There's this idea that you are wearing a mask to the world, that you are unknown to other men and women, that when we come into a temple, we don't see Paul Rana, we don't see Joe Blow, we see the light, we see an aspirant, and we try to see that light within them, not their face, not their personality, not their honors and titles and grades or job or any of that, but we see beyond the physical into the spiritual. And that has developed quite brilliantly in the system. With that being said, that Papu did not have a traceable lineage, and we'll prove that in a little bit. It is absolutely amazing what he and Chabazot and Charles Detre did together. When they created this Martinist order, the initiations are just the most amazing thing. And it has like very little to do with De La Cone, very little to do with CBCS. But what they created, they utilized new symbols, they utilized the original De La Cone hexagram that we've been seeing, you know, the very complex hexagram, but they simplified it to just this simple pentacle, this simple hexagram. A circle with a hexagram with a cross in the center and a hexagon of dotted lines around. And that is the primary symbol of Martinism, the Martinist Pentacle. They utilize this very unique set of regalia. There's no Masonic aprons, it's various robes and cloaks and accoutrements that an individual would wear. And this simple three-degree system brought you through a myth to the truth. And I would say that despite all the various downfalls that sometimes happen in certain monastic orders, or maybe the lack of teaching that can sometimes happen within those, this version of Martinism is, in my opinion, the most effective Martinist way of getting to the truth, okay, and coming to enlightenment, coming to the Philosopher's Stone. It is efficient, it is clean, it is not very easy to get lost in. You know, it can get very easy to get lost in the Golden Dawn. Very easy to get lost in grimoire ceremony magic. Very easy to get lost in the overcome. The CBCS sometimes maybe it's got all the virtues, it's there for those who see it, but it doesn't really drop the hammer very effectively, I think. The truth. Whereas Martinism it works in such a beautiful way. So we have to give Papu, even though he didn't have a lineage, we have to give him that credit that he created something very special. Yes, sir.
Was the title Superior Monkani used before the monastic order?
Before Papu?
Also, does it have any relationship historically with the fourth degree and the Scottish Rite?
Those are good questions. So the question was the term Superior Monkani utilized before Papu's monastic order? We'll start with that one first. And then you said, is there any connection to the Scottish Rite fourth degree? Perfect master. So let's start with the Scottish Rite first. You can go to the Baylock manuscript, which is, you can find it online from the French libraries. There's so much you can find if you know how to read French and search in French. You can find the Baylock manuscript, which has some of the oldest versions of what we now call the Scottish Rite, and they're very different. And even the modern day Scottish Rite has links to some of these degrees. Some of the same symbols are utilized. We're not going to express that just because it would be respectful of the orders. But some of the same symbols and signs are utilized in both these orders. So there is a link there. And a lot of that link probably comes from Willermose and his CBCS Rectified Scottish Rite. As far as the SI, Superior Monkani seems to be the word SI was utilized by Pasquale, as well as was SJ, Sovereign Judge. And in French, an I and a J sometimes get flipped, just like in Hebrew, an I and a J get flipped. Yehovah, Yehovah, Jehovah, Yeheshua, Yeshua, etc. Because when you transliterate, it's not perfect. You know, a Yud can be a Y, an I, or a J. So it was utilized, but maybe not as Superior Monkani. But this links back to Saint Martin, who, when he published, he generally published under a pen name, the unknown philosopher, le philosophe Monkani. So there's that I, Monkani. And the idea of the Superior Monkani also ties into the Elokoan, superior, elect, the Elu, the elect. And in the Elokoan, one of the goals is to have the beatific vision, the vision of the throne of God, the vision of Ezekiel, the Merkava mystics that the Jews work with. It is also to become one of the 144,000 elect of that literal translation, that literal look of the Old Testament. So they are hearkening back to that. You are now an unknown superior, an elect and commune when you come to this grade. Does that help?
Yes.
Cool. So let's check our time real quick. We have this room for another 37 minutes, but there's not a group that comes until 2:30. So we try to blast through this part real quick. The history of the first OM Supreme Council, and I can send you documents too if you're interested later. The Supreme Council was formed in 1891 with such famous members as Stanislas de Guaita, who you might recognize from the Ordre Kabbalistique to the Rose Croix. He also founded the Salon of the Rose Croix, which is an art project in France. The Guggenheim, right now in New York, is doing an exhibit on the Rose Croix salons. And you can go to the Guggenheim and see the original paintings from Peladin and Joseph and Peladin, Stanislas de Guaita and his group. It's supposed to be an amazing thing. Piers Vaughan posted about it yesterday. July 5th, 1892. So, let's do this and then I'll say that. July 5th, 1892, there was a treatise of alliance between the Ordre Martiniste and the Ordre Kabbalistique de la Rose Croix, the Kabbalistic Order of the Rose Cross, which still exists as an independent order and within other orders. There's one based out of Nevada that claims to be the real one, but there's whatever. There's a lot of them out there. So they, the OKRC became the inner order of the OM. You got to SI, then you went to the OKRC. 1895, Papou publishes his book on Martinez de Pasquale. 1899, René Philippon publishes for the first time Pasquale's Reintegration of Beings, a treatise, in French. Then in 1902, this is the first split. 1902, Édouard Blitz, member of the Supreme Council of the OM, breaks with Papou and forms the American Rectified Martinist Order. This is one of the first splits of Martinism. Like, it only lasted 11 years or 12 years before you're already having splinter cells go out. He created the American branch of the OM. And one thing we should talk about is that Papou's initiations were extremely simple. We're talking about like 5, 6, 7 pages. And minimal symbolism, though the core is still there, a series of questions you're asked when you come in, a very simple knighting, almost no mythology in the actual initiation itself. And then you'd get a very simple lecture, which has been published for a long time. The Grand College of Rites published these books twice, many years ago, that anyone who's amazing can get hold of, or just search in the internet and find it. Very simple initiations. Édouard Blitz, when he founded the Rectified Martinist Order, he revised all that into his order, and he published, as early as 1896, The Ritual and Monitor of the Martinist Order by Édouard Blitz, and this is his version of initiations, redeveloped. Now, a lot of this probably still came from Detra, Charles Tedder, who wrote a lot of initiations with Papou, but now you have much more fleshed out, and you have comparisons with the Illuminati of Avignon, with the Illuminated Theosophists of Christianier, the Philoletes group of Savalette de Long, the Primitive Rite of Narbonne, the Rosicrucian Rite. So he fleshed out the initiations, made them much more complex and just better, honestly. So already we have new rituals being used. Then in 1911, there was a treaty of alliance between the OM and l'Église Gnostique Universelle of Jean Bricard. And this was one of the first manifestations of the Gnostic Church. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later. But the EGU at that time, they created an alliance and became sister orders. Like, the official Church of Martinism is this Gnostic Church. 1913, Blitz publishes another ritual Martinist. 1916, the death of Papou. He was succeeded by Tedder in all organizations, including the Memphis Brethren. The OM had become so big that it became a mother order that had the OKRC, the Memphis Brethren, Rose Croix d'Orient, all these different organizations underneath its umbrella. And back then, the SI was just, it wasn't necessarily this hugely coveted thing. You'd go through degrees pretty quickly and get up to third degree. We do something very different now, at least our order does, which we'll talk about. Then we have, from the death of Papou to the Fedosi. 1917, they ratified that treaty between the OM and the EGU, the Gnostic branch. New masters ratified it. In 1920, we have another split. Victor Blanchard, another very important Martinist, member of the Supreme Council, breaks with the Papou Tedder line, with Tedder, and founds the Union Générale des Martinistes et Sénarchiques, which is commonly known as the Order Martiniste et Sénarchique. And this order really blew everything open in a good way. They completely revised the initiations. They created a narrative and mythology that follows logically from first degree all the way to third degree. So now you're not just going through this simple Masonic symbolism, you're truly living the Martinist myth. You're going through the degrees viscerally, experiencing it, which helps you have dream states. It helps you truly integrate the myth. And I would say that when you look at our archives for the OMS are ridiculous. I've got like 2 filing cabinets with all 4 levels just filled with documents, French, English, and we're translating them all ourselves, as well as probably like 30 gigabytes of digital materials. But when you go through all the orders that have come since the OMS, almost everyone is inspired by those rituals and uses some version of it because they're so good. Then in 1931, the surviving members of the first Supreme Council reunite with Chavezer, who had split. And they found Lord of Martigny's Traditionnel, the TMO, which, if you've ever heard of AMORC Incorporated, that is their inner order of Martinism. Now, the thing about TMO, they have a legitimate lineage, but they're like the one order that doesn't recognize any other Martinist order and are not recognized by any other Martinist order. They're very elitist, and they're very isolated, I should say. 1934, the death of Ricard. He's succeeded by Constant Chevillon as the head of VOM and all of its bodies. Chevillon was martyred, which we'll see later. Then in 34, we have the first convention of Fedosi, the Federation Universelle des Ordres et Societies Initiatiques, the Universal Federation of Orders and Initiatory Societies. This brought together literally everything under the sun that was going on in esotericism at that time. It only lasted for like 15 years, but it was an amazing organization that accomplished a lot of fantastic stuff. Milka Bogard has a 100-page paper on Fedosi that is extremely illuminating that you can check out. And likewise, if you're interested in this stuff, we can give you Milka Bogard's Manifestations of the Martinist Order, which is like a 200-page awesome document about these orders. And just to keep things moving so we don't run out of time, all these orders started splitting and reforming. Then Ambalan comes around in the 40s and revives the Yellow Koan for the first time. He rewrites the Yellow Koan and finds original source materials that they didn't have before. He begins doing the equinox operations, the ceremony and magic operations again, in France in 1942. The first night it was just 8 people. The next equinox was 12, 16, then it was 24. Then it was all over France. And they would all meet at the exact same time at midnight on the equinox and do their operations. And this is when Martinism really came back to life. It was under Ambalan. We have him to thank for almost everything. So all these things happen. Augustin Chavezeau died, and then Philippe Ancausse takes over, and just all these things happen. Ambalan becomes the head of just about everything everywhere, and then in the 40s, 1948, he publishes Lamartinism, which in that book he proves the invalidity of the Papu San Martin lineage. He proves that it never existed. But he also proves that he was able to go to Russia and find the princes, the lineages of the princes that San Martin personally initiated, that have an unbroken line of succession through the CBCS, the RER. So he, at first, that was kind of his like way of being like, you guys are fake and I'm real, like a political battle. But eventually what happens is they all reunite and they share lineages. So when Martinist orders battle about who has lineage, most of them have lineage nowadays. It's kind of a moot point, because Ambalan and his successors shared everything. So most people do have lineage. The question is, do they have teachings? Just because you have lineage doesn't mean you actually have documents or teachings or know what you're talking about. So all these things happen. The RER gets a new grand priory. Orders split and fall and unite, et cetera, et cetera. New orders are created, Lord of Martinis de Pebe, Lord of Martinis Libre. The Union of Martinis Orders forms and is dissolved. The Order of Martinis Initiatique comes around, etc., etc. And then in the 90s, Robert Amadou and Serge Caillé founded the Eleazar Institute, which is not an order, but it's an institution dedicated just to study, research, and dissemination of the tradition. And they've been extremely helpful to the Martinist tradition in reviving all this stuff. So with that, let's talk a little bit about some of the different kinds of orders that are out there. You come into, and this is not meant to be a bash towards any other order, it's just to help everyone have education on what these orders are. There is an individual recently, I'm not going to say any names, but did a lecture and said that if you're not part of the Order Martiniste, and the Grand Master did not approve your initiation, you are not a Martinist. And if you take that perspective, then basically 90% of Martinism and its history shouldn't exist. And 90% of it is illegitimate. And all the great writings of these individuals that have enlivened the tradition so much over the past 100 years don't qualify. So if we throw out Ambulon, we throw out Amadou, we throw out all these individuals that split, Edouard Blitz, Augustin Chavisseau, we throw these individuals out, what do you have left? You have just this very weak system of high-grade masonry that's just a Grand Master's Club, instead of actually doing its purpose of transmitting light and transforming people's consciousness. So everyone's entitled to their opinion, but most Martinist orders will say that if you're a Martinist, you're a Martinist. I don't care what order you are, you're a Martinist. Because they all have lineage, and the whole thing about Martinism, it was never meant to be this battle of orders and politics. That's completely antithetical to its principles and what it's supposed to be about. So anyways, any questions on all of that before we're now going to start talking about the modern presentation? So, we here in Austin have been working Martinism for quite a long time in various ways, in various organizations. And Friday, October 13th, 2013, we founded the Ordre Martin Souverain, shortened as the OMS. It was founded by six initiators from various orders and lineages. And what happened is we were involved in an order that had that got really political. There was a change in leadership, and things just went south. And we didn't want to be a part of that anymore. So we stepped back, we resigned from that order in all leadership positions, we closed our temple with them, and went independent. And we just spent about a year, just collecting information from all of our initiators and contacts internationally, and we're extremely blessed to have some really good contacts that just gave us everything. And we just collected all these lineages, rituals, curriculum, and manuscripts from the tradition, and we realized how big the tradition is. You know, when in 2013, we knew nothing, relatively nothing, about the Elocoan and the CBCS. We had little snippets that most people get from internet sources. But since then, we've been able to get initiated through all these degrees, revise all of them, translate manuscripts, and begin the reconstruction of the Martinist tradition for the next generation. So our organization brings together all three branches of historical Martinism: the Elocoan, the first manifestation, the CBCS, the second manifestation, and the Way of the Heart, the San Martin. Our original tenets, our work is exemplified by the intentions of the founding members in these 5 points. Namely, Martinism exists for the sole purpose of the transmission of the light and is a vehicle for the gift of the royal secret, as we call it, the stone of the philosophers, which dissolves and unites all mysteries of heaven and of earth. That is its only purpose. If you're doing something else, you're missing the point. This gift carries within it the rights and burden of self-sovereignty. That's why our name is Souverain. It's inherent. The OMS will make sovereignty the truth and truth, the core of its initiations, rituals, doctrine, and the order, while staying true to the historical landmarks of Martinism. And there's a great document by Ridgely Hunt on the public domain called Landmarks of Martinism. The Grand Council of SI, which is our Grand Council, will develop and perpetuate Martinism in line with the principles above for its transmission in a new era. And if the order should ever cease to operate by the above principles, it shall be dissolved. So that was our original tenets we wrote in October 2013. Since then, we've completely revised the Martinist tradition. And just like every other order, we start with a three-degree system: associate, initiate, SI. But what we do differently is we infuse each of those degrees with the old currents. So the first degree is also an example of the first manifestation Martinism, the Elocoan. We call it the associate Elu. Instead of just the associate Elu, the associate elect. This degree comprises the traditional formulas of Papu, his order Martinist, and San Martin, but is enriched with the current of the Elocoan in Martinus de Pasquale. It comprises initiatory experience similar to that of the traditional Martinist associate and the fourth degree of the Elocoan. The grade curriculum we give is comprised of 3 books. So this is another thing about Martinist orders that are out there. A lot of those orders, you come in and you don't even get a single piece of paper for any curriculum. You get nothing to study. We give this whole stack. for our first degree. Those are just the physical books. These are the mandatory books, these first three, and then these ones are supplemental. We also give those out digitally as free PDFs. And everything we publish is published at cost. Everything is completely transparent. No one's making any money off anything. But we give them this whole stack of books, and we also give them on our online international forums where they can talk with all the members internationally, different temples. We give them probably like 3,000 pages of PDFs of historical Martinist curriculum. So if there is an order out there that's not giving their members something, it's a travesty, because there is so much out there. Like, your members deserve to actually learn and not just be a part of a Grand Master's Club. The Associate Elu Handbook, the first handbook, is comprised of theory and practice. Everything is. The theory is a distillation of the most refined associate level texts of Martinism, while the practice provides traditional Martinist meditations of the way of the heart, but also Elu Kohen operations up to the fourth degree. So you're doing ceremony magic right away. You're doing traditional meditations, Christian mysticism right away. You're drawing circles in the floor. There's a lot of really interesting stuff. Then we also have the Elu Kohen Theory Handbook, which provides key historical documents from the past masters, Pasquale's writings, Saint Martin's, Willermoes, that help us to understand the tradition. Then we also publish the essential writings of Saint Martin, which are key documents of the unknown philosopher, 350 pages. Our first degree, we require a minimum of 1 to 2 years of active study, active work, in order to pass on to the second degree. When someone comes to the second, so for those online, there's a stack of our 4 primary books for the first degree, as well as an example of our Martin certificate. One thing about our certificates, they don't look like other orders, because we were able to find Pasquale's original certificates that he gave to Willermoes, dated 1768, and we were able to get high resolutions of these and recreate them, so we actually have these sigils on our certificate, and it's written in the style of that. And then, just like down here, we have stamps for each degree, so you get this beautiful certificate this size, 11 by 17 parchment. So as much as we can, we try to go back to the original sources and utilize that. Unlike other Martinist orders, that there's some orders you'll go in there and they'll teach you the Lesser Banishing Ritual Pentagram. Like, that's a Golden Dawn technique from way later. That doesn't belong in Martinism. Unlike them, we only use the Martinist tradition. We only use source texts. We don't try to create something new that's not necessary. Our second degree of Initiate Chevalier. Initiate is a traditional, Chevalier means knight, so Initiate Knight, or Mystic Knight. This continues the work of the first degree, and it comprises the traditional formulas of Papu and Saint Martin, but infused with the current of the CBCS, of Jean-Baptiste Willermoes. In addition to an innovative way of the heart second degree, it comprises an initiatory experience from the CBCS, distilled from the 4th degree Scottish Master St. Andrew, the 5th degree Squire Novice, and the 6th degree Beneficent Knight, grades of Willermoes. Those things are implanted and distilled into the degree itself. The Initiate Handbook, this one's just one handbook, but you still get all this extra digital stuff. This handbook consists of theory and practice, again, just like the first. And we get CBCS lectures for all those grades that teach you about the Temple of Jerusalem, teach you about the classical virtues, chivalry, spiritual knighthood. And we extend the Elu Kohen operations now to a 9-month operation, in which a 9-month mystical and magical operation with prayers 4 times a day and a big ritual once a week that requires what Pasquale called passes or visions, signs that you have to relate to us and write a paper on. We have to see fact that you're actually getting the work done. And there are tests, and you should actually see certain visions and certain things. And over that 2-year grade, you have to provide those in order to get into the SI degree. So we hold things to a much higher standard. Part of the reason why we've infused those traditions into the grades is, first of all, it works naturally. We go through the first manifestation, the second, then the third. But also, we want our SIs to not just be SIs by title only, not just be like, here, give us some money, you're an SI. We want them to be fully conversant, fully knowledgeable, so that the day after their initiation, they could turn around and start a temple. and they are fully conversant in the entire Marxist tradition, unlike so many SIs that are out there, unfortunately. So there's an example for those on the internet of our the covers of our Initiate Chevalier curriculum. And you'll see on the right, that is a 1700s Templar drawing from the National Library of France. So finally, we come to the third degree, the SI. And this comprises the traditional formulas of Saint Martin and Papu, but with additional components that unify everything we've done in the first two degrees into a holistic unity. This is the cornerstone of the LMS, this degree, and it forms the chamber in which the royal secret is revealed, the gift and burden which confers sovereignty and truth. The SI handbook focuses on deepening the newly raised SI's understanding of the royal secret through what we call the wet path of alchemy, the slow path. It includes the Abramelin operation, which is the quintessential magical operation of any mystic order out there. Everyone goes through it. As well as other Rosicrucian operations to assist in unfolding the rose of creation, the rose of the mystery. And this degree culminates, as I said, in the unveiling of the royal secret, or the stone, of the philosophers, that elusive yet ever-present mystery which forms the foundation of all true initiation and all illumination. So that is our outer order. And then when someone accomplishes that, they come into the SI, they are invited to Le Collège du Supérieur Inconnu, the SI College. And in the college, you can see there's some examples of just some of the initiations. A lot of them. There's like 33 now. That's just a coincidence. Has nothing to do with the Scottish Rite. At the grade of SI, the CSI opens. And it's not mandatory, but it's optional. If someone wants to continue their training and go through the full traditional Ellicon initiations, the full traditional CBCS, they can do that. And we offer that not as... The thing is, at the SI, you've come to the truth. You've come to enlightenment. There's nothing more to learn. But these are ways you can deeper your understanding, and you know the history of Marxism better, and therefore the history of other esoteric orders. Here's some examples of some Ellicon operations and initiations. Again, more circles that are used in various operations. And then we have the Grand Council. Bad title, I should say Grand Council. We have the Grand Council, just so everyone knows. We're very transparent about the order. The order is governed by the Grand Council, which forms the sovereign tribunal of the order. All local lodge masters and councils are appointed by the Grand Council. The local masters and temples have a certain autonomy in day-to-day operations, such as admission of candidates, elevation of candidates through grades, through the first two degrees. The GCSI, however, the Grand Council does all third-degree initiations. Everyone has to be initiated by the council, so we know it's done right. So the SI works. Likewise, the Grand Council does all SIIs and makes all masters, et cetera, et cetera. And it is composed of a tribunal of three individuals. There's never one person running the order, because that's how bad things happen. There's always a triangle. There's always a balance there. Another unique thing that we've done is we mentioned how there were those treaties signed between the Gnostic Church and Order Martiniste back in the early 1900s. Martinism played an important role in the French Gnostic revival, as did the Gnostic Church. And most of today's Gnostic currents come from this era and these Martinist individuals. Some Martinist orders still publicly or privately ordain in the Gnostic Church. For us, in order to re-enliven this historical aspect of Martinism, the bishops of the OMS, which we have multiple bishops within our order, have brought together dozens of Orthodox and Gnostic lineages, and our ordinations are unique in that they are actual initiatory and they're alchemical. It's not like what you're going to get from the liberal Catholic Rite or from the EGAC or Ecclesia Gnostica, et cetera, et cetera. It'll have those cornerstones, but there's alchemical processes you're going through, inner theosophical processes. And this is just an example real quick. I know you guys can't really read that probably, but these are an example of some of our Orthodox apostolic successions. We have the Roman Catholic successions, We have the Antiochian Jacobite, Russian Orthodox, Coptic Orthodox, Liberal Catholic Church, you name it, basically. And then these are some of our Gnostic successions. So Ecclesia Gnostica, Templar Gnostic Churches, et cetera, et cetera.